davening at gravesides of tzaddikim and at the Kosel, one doesn't have to go to Israel. We can talk to God anywhere. So here's what I decided to do. I took upon the following. Tshuva, the magnitude of our repentance will be commensurate with the magnitude of our search-searching. I decided that it's easy to blame others for not finding a shidduch. But in all honesty, I figured the main reason I wasn't married was that I had to improve as a person. If I could somehow raise my level of spirituality, this might make me a vessel to receive my bereshit. So I did this by going to Torah classes, by reading Musar Sfarim, or ethics books, for self-improvement, by keeping a cheshbon nefesh, which is a daily accounting, something that I tell every single to do that I do every day. And I can send you a PDF document which shows all the basic violations all of us commit on a daily basis. And why is that important if you do a cheshbon nefesh, a daily accounting? Because every time we commit a crime, it goes in our IOU, in our file in Shemayim. These are the IOUs that could stop the salvation of us getting a Yeshua, getting a salvation, and meriting to have a soulmate come into our lives. But if we do an accounting every day, we eliminate these IOUs, and the only individual that can do that is us. If you need that, just reach out to me at 305-206-1916 and I'll send you a PDF of how to do a personal accounting daily and eliminate these IOUs that could be the roadblocks that are stopping you from meeting your soulmate. I went to Torah classes, she writes. I decided to look around and I joined Torah classes of various classes that I liked. I did a cheshbon nefesh, a personal accounting. I also felt the joy of another single simcha, something that we can learn in this time of the year. Hashem wants us not only to think about how we can better serve Him, but how can we feel good and feel happy for someone else's joy? How do we measure spiritual growth? I measured mine, this older single said, by my reaction when my friends became engaged. On hearing about another single simcha, I was happy for my friend. But my honest reaction was not, why not me? As I progressed in my personal development, I stopped asking the question. My friend's groom was meant for her. My shidduch, my zivuk, my soulmate will be meant for me, so I don't have to worry about it. I began to feel the other bride's joy. In fact, I remember dancing at one friend's wedding with such delight that it was almost as though it was my own simcha. What's another thing that I can do? Chesed, achnasas orchem. I decided to start an organization that would help place people in my town for Shabbos, so no person would go have to spend the Shabbos alone. And that was something which was amazing. There's no doubt in my mind that chesed contributed to my growth. Instead of focusing on myself, I was busy helping others. I think I gained more than the people I accommodated. Some of the hosts, sensitive to my being single, invited me to join them for meals. I went, and some of the women that I also got invited are now my closest friends. Stucca. One evening I walked with my friend through Yerushalayim in an area called Me'ar Sha'arim, which is an area, Hasidic enclave. She was about to have her first child after many years of marriage. I davened for her husband after many years of waiting. As we walked, I noticed that she gave money to each and every person who approached her. Giving tzedakah is a big, big segula, or a spiritual remedy, she explained. Rav Chaim Pinchas Scheinberg was the rabbi that was known to wear hundreds of tzitzis, said I should give to everyone that asks me. And so I decided to do the same thing. I gave tzedakah, a penny or a nickel or a quarter, to everyone that came up to me to ask for charity. I was more generous in my thoughts as well as my purse. And as a result, charity creates a bond, I thought. Tefillah, I prayed. I looked at my prayer, I analyzed it, and I said, where can I go better? Realizing the importance of receiving brachas from tzaddikim, I visited many. I visited many rabbis and got brachas and blessings from many tzaddikim. I davened in shul instead of davening at home, although this time, if you're in an area where you can't go to shul, that's okay because of the corona epidemic. But when that does come back, consider davening in shul where God's presence is felt more acutely. I also davened for myself. I started to talk to God in what we call his bodidus, which is personal discussions with God in your language. I started to pour out my feelings to God. And I always feel that in doing hidbodidut, the first thing you should do is read the thank you card and thank God for all the wonderful things that He's done in your life and thank Him for the things that are not going your way. Because gratitude is one of the greatest ways to open the doorway to a salvation from God and get married. And I advocate this to all of my singles. And if you need a copy of the thank you card, no problem. Just reach out to me at 305-206-1916 and I'll get you a copy of the card. I began engaging in his boydidus, which is personal prayer. I talked to God, pouring out my heart to Him, though I considered myself a relatively happy, upbeat person. But sometimes I would cry and plead to Him as being single. I remember one night just lying in bed, imploring Hashem, please help me. As my tears flowed, I thought of Avigdor Miller, who said, we should cry out to God when we're in pain. It's not that Hashem needs our cries, he said. It's that we need Hashem, and the more we cry out to Him and speak to Him, the more we show Him that we need Him, and more that connection develops and becomes deeper and deeper. And so what happened? Shortly afterwards, I met the man who was to become my husband. He was a widower with a charming daughter. She was 9 years old. And keep in mind an important lesson here, ladies and gentlemen. She wasn't holding out for a single man, as many people come to me. No, I can't have a divorce. So often I try to get a single person to open up to an individual that I might recommend to them who's married, previously married, who's had a child or two, but is a fantastic human being. Or she's a fantastic human being, but they're so fixated with what they expect that they want to have that they may sit on a golden opportunity. This woman, her options were open. She came to learn that you have to become more global, and she was willing to entertain someone who came into her life. He was a good man, even if he had a child, that's fine, she said, and I'll be a good mother to her. As long as I'm asking Hashem, he'll always help me. So she was open-minded. She allowed God to allow the blessing to come into her life, and the blessing came into her life, and that was so important. So I'd like to close with an amazing story which shows us how what goes around in life comes around, that God is always in our lives, and even if we think that it's over, it's not over. That God's always there and He can make tremendous miracles. A woman by the name of Naomi Raskin writes the following. She grew up in Russia after the war, and it was 1946 when she was a child during World War II, and they wanted to escape communist Russia. The year was 1946 and I was 12 at the time, but all vestiges of my childhood had long been stolen by the Russian regime that promised freedom but delivered death. Our escape plans were made of hushed whispers that changed by the minute. Mapped quickly by my father after the KGB, which is the Russian Secret Service, raided the soap factory that he owned and operated to provide for our family without working on Shabbos. There were people who had made the journey before us, escaping the USSR, which was the Soviet Union, where it seemed that it was impossible to leave this Iron Curtain. And from the stories that floated over the Iron Curtain, we knew that they had survived and it was possible to get to the other side alive. The journey began with a train ride through the city that led us away from the large home and familiar neighborhood where we had lived. As days bled into weeks, we huddled close with nothing but our own possessions and bare bone essentials. We had left everything behind. Forged documents and little diamonds sewn into the soles of our shoes, which would serve as payment to all the people that were going to help us, the tour guides. We passed landscapes, parks, and train stations until the brick and mortar of the city faded entirely. I didn't look out the window or stare at fellow passengers. Instead, I observed my surroundings in glances, my eyes peeled for signs of danger. We were so worried we could be caught at any moment and taken back and thrown into jails in Soviet Union, sent to Siberia. We were quiet travelers, speaking only when necessary in words that were carefully distorted. As we passed through checkpoints, our faces were slack with expressions while our hearts trembled. Perhaps we would be caught at any moment. In the world I lived, the art of nonchalance came with ease. After days of travel along the scalloped edges of the Russian border, the train crossed over into Poland. The train had crossed off finally into Poland. Relieved to have made it out of Russia alive, we joined 46 other escapees and took refuge in a shul which was gutted and abandoned in Poland after the war. Although we had made it out of Russia, the danger was far from over. Poland was in its own state of post-war turmoil, and we waited in limbo as the leaders of our group attempted to sort out what would be the next leg of our journey. During that time, I got up every morning hoping that today was the day we'll move on. We were crowded into a small space, sleeping on the floor, bored and hungry, all the time hungry. One night while we slept on the cold floor, I was awakened by shouts. I sat up, my fight or flight response honed from years of living in fear, and dove into an alcove in the corner of the room. The shouts grew louder, followed by stomping feet and then the cry of gunshots loud enough to feel like the air itself was shuddering around me. In my corner, I suddenly felt someone beside me, sheltering, protecting my body. Batsheva, stay down! Batsheva, stay down! It was my father speaking in a ragged whisper. I curled into a ball, listening to my father's rapid breathing above my head, counting each of his breaths to calm myself. A moment later, it was quiet, and then shouts started again. I covered my face with my hands, squeezing my eyes closed, wondering if this was how it would end. A moment passed, then another moment. Slowly, I lifted my head. I could feel my father standing up, moving towards the door. I held my breath, bracing for a gunshot. Instead, voices rose and fell, eventually fading into a thick, heavy silence. It's okay now, my father said to everyone. I sat up, trembling, my eagle eyes scouting for my mother, brother, and sister. Spotting them in their own safe corner, I turned back to my father. What happened, Tati? He didn't know the exact story. There was a language barrier, and the officers were eager to leave. It seemed that one police officer had known this building was full of Jewish refugees with illegal papers, and he decided to take matters into his own hands. Shaken and terrified, no one slept that night. It was a miracle that not a single one of us was harmed. Hashem had made a miracle for us. Experiencing the peril of Poland's chaos and fearing another attack, we knew it was time to move on. Early the next morning, my father left to gather provisions for the long journey ahead. When he returned, he was holding a Sefer Torah in a wooden box. I'd never seen a Sefer Torah before. As my father opened the latch, my breath caught. I stared at the rolled parchment, mesmerized by the little black letters on a smooth parchment. I found a Polish Jew looking to sell it, my father said. I couldn't give up the opportunity of buying a Sefer Torah to protect us for the journey. We left the next day at dusk, traveling by train to the border between Poland and Czechoslovakia, where a guide was going to meet us and to be paid an astronomical sum to take us over to Czechoslovakia and cross the Polish-Czechoslovakian border through a dense forest. We gathered at a meeting spot, which was a messy huddle, waiting for the guide and hoping he would arrive, while preparing ourselves for the long trek through the forest. My teeth chattered as I shivered in a coat, matted after weeks of travel. As we waited, I thought of the attack in the abandoned shul. I looked at the wooden box my father clutched tightly in his hands, telling myself that we had to be safe. We had a Sefer Torah now. We were going to be okay. We were protected by the Sefer Torah. As the guide arrived and whistled a signal, my father removed a coarse rope and tossed it to me. I grabbed it, holding tightly to the thick, scratchy threads into my skin. We were going to go through the forest holding this rope. There, as a second signal from the guide that indicated we were about to begin, and we started to move forward into the black, dense forest ahead. The moon was slivered that night, with ghostly shapes, giving off only enough light to let us see how vast and dark the forest was. As we entered a clearance between trees, it felt like we were being swallowed into a dark pit. In the distance, I heard the hooting of owls and snapping branches as animals moved through and around us in the forest. I squeezed the rope, forcing my feet onward, trying not to trip on the underbrush. With time, I became accustomed to the quiet of a group of 46 refugees wading through the wild under the cover of night. The crunch of dry leaves, the inky darkness, the whips of the wind, and the muffled cries when someone's foot got caught in the foliage. The minutes crawled as we walked on. With no landscapes to mark how far we had gone and no change in the scenery around us, I lost all sense of time and counted my own steps to keep myself focused. I don't know if it was an hour later or several, but at one point the silence was broken by my mother calling to my father in an urgent whisper. Immediately I snapped my head upward, casting glances, looking for the danger. Not finding anything suspicious, I turned back to my mother and saw that she had lifted my little sister and was struggling to hold her. My father broke out of the assembly line to reach for my sister, and then he staggered to that spot, one heavy weight in each arm. Standing directly behind him, I could see his footsteps and knew he would not be able to hold both my sister and his Sefer Torah. My sister couldn't walk anymore. So in one hand, my father was carrying my sister, and the other hand, he was carrying this wooden box of the Sefer Torah, an almost unhuman thing to be able to do for hours. Several minutes later, he left the assembly line once more to gently lay the box with the Torah against the tree trunk. My father didn't have a choice. It was my sister or the Sefer Torah. He had to decide to take my sister. He remained there for a brief moment and then returned to the line, his two arms around my sister. Eyes focused forward, I allowed myself to look back for a tiny moment, straining to see the outline of the wooden box at the foot of the tree. We had to abandon the Sefer Torah. The sight of the abandoned Torah called upon the emotion of my young life. Fear. What would it mean for us if we continued without the Torah's protection? I had come to symbolize that Sefer Torah had come to symbolize our protection, and now that we didn't have it going through the forest, what would be with us? Standing directly behind my father, I couldn't see his face at all, but I heard the hitch in his breathing and saw the rapid rise and fall of his shoulders. For my father, abandoning the Torah did not make him feel afraid, but it caused him enough pain to release a flood of tears that I had never seen him cry during years of suffering and oppression. As a child of 12, witnessing this effect had on my father left such an indelible mark on my life that I would forever associate the journey to freedom with my father's tears as he had to abandon that Sefer Torah. We made it over the Czech border just before dawn. By the time we reached the abandoned shul where we had been spending the next few days, long fingers of sunlight streaked the skies. We spent the next few days in a foreign, hostile land with barely any access to food as the organizers planned the next leg of the journey. We were sheltered away in yet another decrepit building, a weary band of travelers hiding from the world. Eventually, we moved on by train and foot across the continent until we boarded a boat that took us to Eretz Yisrael. I lived there for several years until I married and resettled in Canada, where my husband and I served as Chabad Shluchim in a suburb of Toronto, slowly building a wonderful, growing community. Many years later, Ms. Raskin writes, on a trip to California, we were invited to the home of Fagi Estelin, whose parents had made a similar escape from the Soviet Union shortly after we had. Listen to this amazing story, ladies and gentlemen. During the course of our stay, Fagi shared the story of her own parents' journey. My parents were at the last stretch of an escape from the Soviet Union that had dragged on for weeks, Fagi told us. They were walking in a dense forest on a dark, cold night, and they suddenly realized my 5-year-old sister wasn't with them. There were moments of chaos while some members of the group tried to barter with the guide to wait, while others began the frantic search to look for my five-year-old sister. My father dropped down on his hands, Feige says, and knees, and crawled along the forest floor, desperately groping in the darkness. After several frantic minutes, he found my sister sitting on the floor, leaning against the wooden box. He grabbed my sister and then opened the box and discovered the Sefer Torah inside. He unraveled the Torah, wrapped it around his own body, and tied it with his gartel. The group continued on their way, the Torah coming along with them for the rest of the journey. Feige continued to speak, but the words that she said, making me start to spin, I turned white as a ghost. I dropped my head into my shaking hands, my mind desperately trying to work the shocking news into my memories. In my mind, the Torah was still on the forest floor, lost between the Polish and Czechoslovakian border, and I couldn't fit the image that I had held for years with Feige's revelation, that the Sefer Torah that my father had abandoned had actually made it back with Feige's father. When it finally penetrated, I started to cry, unleashing the tears I had never shed. Throughout the years, despite everything I had gone through, the image that haunted me was not the KGB officers breaking into the soap factory, nor was it the police officer shooting at us in an abandoned shul, but the image of my father's heaving shoulders as he left the Torah behind, and the outpouring of cries from my father as they had to leave that Sefer Torah behind. No matter how much he had given up for the Torah, leaving a physical Sefer Torah to the elements had broken my father. My father was no longer alive to hear the end of this wonderful story, but the little girl who still lived inside me, the 12-year-old girl who had seen far too much for her young years and once upon a time fantasized of a rescue from a life of oppression, was finally comforted in the knowledge that, like us, my father's Sefer Torah had found a miraculous way home. And ladies and gentlemen, we'll find our way home. As we end these 3 weeks, we pray to Hashem this epidemic, this pandemic should end, and He should finally bring an end to this galus, to this exile. And if we could learn the messages from this exile, that Hashem loves us, He just wants us to turn to Him now, and to try to use this time to do a little introspection, to do a little tshuva, to talk to Him, to get closer to Him, to do cheshbon and nefesh, then we can be rest assured that God willing, for every single, they shall find their soulmate. And just as a last word, if anyone out there would like my help in any way, whether it's in shidduchim, whether it's in matchmaking, or helping them evaluate a relationship that they're in, whether it's dating or shalom bayis if they're married, please feel free to reach out to me at 305-206-1916 or email me at drjackcohen18@gmail.com. Have a wonderful day and have a most introspective 3 weeks. It should be most fulfilling as we greet Mashiach Tzidkenu b'Rabbeinu Amen.